Good evening and welcome to Writers on Writing. I'm your host, Dr. Brenda Greene, and we come to you every Sunday and give you, our listening audience, an opportunity to hear writers from the African diaspora talk about their work, their lives, and their craft. And we are coming to you from the studio of Medgar Evers College over the airways of WNYE 91.5 FM. We come to you every Sunday, and I'm very pleased to have with me in the studio today an interesting writer, the editor of a new online journal, ZAWADI Morris. Welcome, ZAWADI.
Thank you. Thank you for having me.
Yeah. So we generally end up talking very often to fiction writers and poets and memoirists and playwrights. And this is a little bit different because we have you in our studio talking about an area of writing that is really rapidly growing.
Yes.
And is really kind of taken over how many of us get our news. And just to share with the audience, I'm going to ask you to also fill in that you started off as a journalist and went into media relations. And you've been doing this for close to, 20 years?
I almost hate to say it, but yeah, it's been about 20 years, 20 fast years. As soon as I came out of graduate school, I went to Northwestern's Medill School of Journalism. I started working as a press secretary. I had a wonderful opportunity to work on Capitol Hill for New York City Congresswoman Nydia Velazquez. So that was really my first job right out of college, and it put me on the PR track. It put me into public relations, and I didn't realize that at the time, but my first professional experience really was in public relations, but my academic background was, in fact, in journalism, and that's where my interest lies, is in journalism.
Okay, so why were you motivated to go into journalism? Tell us a little bit more about your writing life and how you came to love writing, first of all.
I discovered that I loved writing, but didn't acknowledge it to myself. But as a young girl, my family, I'm from Chicago, and we grew up on the south side in a project called All Gale Gardens.
Okay.
And my family was one of the original families that was chosen to participate in a program called Gautreaux that moved families from the projects into the wealthier suburbs. And so we were one of, I believe, 10 families that were moved out in 1978. And it was a big adjustment for us. We were the only black family. We integrated that neighborhood. And I had a very difficult time really understanding what was happening to my family in our life. And so my mom encouraged me to write about it. She said, well, if you're so frustrated and you're so upset and you come home every day and you're complaining about this and that teacher mistreating you, she's like, just write about it.
That's very interesting because that's not something that's really, when we think about our community, that's really central to our community. And I know that when my sons were growing up, I looked actively for places where I could get them to do more creative writing that outside of the school writing. So it's very interesting that your mother would encourage you to go into writing and to do
yeah.
that.
Yeah, and this was at a time where we had typewriters.
Oh, okay.
So I think at around age 10, I sat down on her Royal typewriter, and I decided I was going to write a book, this novel book about a 9-year-old black girl who's grown up in an all-white suburb and all of her trials and tribulations. And so I spent that summer writing this book that ended up being about maybe 12 pages in the end, but it was typewritten, and I stapled it, and it was my first book. I was very proud of it. I showed it to my mom at the end of the summer, and I loved it. I spent a lot of time on that typewriter, and I really loved it. And so the subsequent summers I spent writing, you know, typing, okay. typing my stories. I started doing poetry. And then, you know, fast forward through high school, through college, I thought that I was going to go into medicine. I had decided I wanted to be an obstetrician gynecologist.
Oh, what a difference.
I still liked writing, but it just didn't occur to me as a career path at all. It was in college when I started getting feedback from my teachers. It didn't, you know, you have to do a lot of writing in college. So it didn't matter what grade I would get. It could be an A, it could be a B, C, even some D's. But the teacher always said to me, "You're an excellent writer." They're like, "Well, you need to work on this. You need to work on your thematic structure. But you're an excellent writer." And I noticed that was a consistent, "You're a great writer." So when it was around time for me to graduate and I was trying to figure out what I wanted to do, I no longer was interested in medicine. I had gotten a business degree and I had a couple of foreign languages under my belt. I decided, you know, I want to do what Christiane Amanpour is doing. I want to be an international writer, a public affairs reporter. And so then I decided to go on ahead and apply to journalism school. And it was the best decision I could have ever made. I absolutely love writing. I love what I do.
Okay, so fast forward to the Brooklyn Reader.
Yes.
Now, what was the motivation behind starting the Brooklyn Reader? First, tell our audience about the Brooklyn Reader.
Okay.
And then the motivation behind starting that journal.
The Brooklyn Reader is an online news platform. It's a hyper-local news platform for information coming out of Central Brooklyn, which includes the neighborhoods of Bedford-Stuyvesant, Fort Greene, Clinton Hill, and Crown Heights. And we'll soon be opening up some more. We'll be doing coverage also in May, hopefully, in East Flatbush and Brownsville, East New York, and Prospect Heights. So basically, it's just a platform for the community to receive information, exchange information, dialogue, and also receive the latest news on a granular level that speaks to their neighborhood, who they are. And so it's a hyper-local news channel, and it went live December 16th.
Okay, so you're cutting across, as you said, a number of neighborhoods, and you've just gone live. How do you get those people to write for those for the Brooklyn Reader? Or are you doing most of the writing?
I am doing a lion's share of the writing, but that's my goal is, you know, moving forward, having the paper, the online paper itself, really self-automated by the community. I'm really trying to encourage the community to dialogue, to talk, to write, to think about, you know, their positions on things. So I did an extensive kind of outreach before the launch to a number of people that I knew who were excellent in their fields, who had a strong point of view. And I sat down with them individually and talked to them about what I was trying to do with the Reader and asked them if, you know, I said, I'd be honored if you would lend your voice and your expertise as a columnist or as a blogger. So before the launch, I was able to bring on board a combination of 16 bloggers and writers who right now write for the site, and they're all from the neighborhoods that we cover. And I'm looking for more writers, and I'm still looking for more reporters. The reporters, and there's really three ways to contribute to the site, either as a blogger or as a columnist or as a reporter. So the bloggers and the columnists kind of write casually about either their field of expertise or what they're experiencing in the neighborhood. That's basically the common voice. That's the voice of the neighborhood. My reporters are doing more hard news reporting, daily reporting, going out in the field, doing interviews. And those are the ones that usually have writing experience or are coming out of journalism school or are interested in being a journalist.
All right. Are you doing anything like reviews of the arts, reviews of books, reviews of shows? And
absolutely. the writers, they have beats. You know, I encourage them. I ask them, you know, when I sit down with them or in the initial interview process, I ask them, you know, what are you interested in? Because there are a number of areas that we're trying to cover, and definitely arts and entertainment and culture is a big component of what makes up Central Brooklyn. So,
We're the center. That's where poets, musicians are coming.
So that we're definitely covering that. Definitely.
Okay. And how often are you updating? I mean, how often? I know, like the patch, we go back to the patch that comes out daily.
Yes, I was the editor for 3 years for Bed-Stuy Patch. And it's a similar format as Bed-Stuy Patch, and it's really where I got my feet wet in doing online digital journalism. And so it's a daily. It's updated daily.
It is daily.
Oh, yes, absolutely. Mm-hmm. We have, you'll see between 6 to 10 posts a day going up on the site.
And you have to really, really be passionate about this because, you know, I was talking to someone about those who we just lost a cultural worker, institutional builder, John Watusi Branch, the founder of the African Poetry Theater. And just listening to what he had done and his passion for starting that. You're starting this online journals because you're passionate about it. So how are you making a living? I say, how does one, and you don't have to personalize this, how does one do the kind of writing and the kind of work you're doing and still manage to survive?
Oh, wow. That's almost a loaded question. It's very layered. Right now, I'm sure you know, working with journalism students and writers, that writing is definitely not the field you go into if you're looking to make a lot of money.
That's
it has
right.
to be, your motivation really has to be about bringing information, sharing information, and encouraging others to do the same. So that's not to say that it shouldn't be something that we monetize or try to become wealthy with, but that definitely cannot be your driving motivation. And so that it's not my driving motivation. Now, I am also a businesswoman. I went to school for business, and I had a lot of options coming out of college, and I've explored a lot of options that pay much better than what I'm doing, you know, now as a writer. But I am able to, the site is monetized. We do have advertising on the site. So in the digital realm, I do what any other person does that has a website, and I reach out to my readers actually the advertisers that are interested in my readers, and I seek advertising for the site. So the site is monetized. And that's something that, you know, you have to really kind of pay very close attention to when you're looking at websites, because you've got a lot of noise out there. You've got a lot of blogs. You've got a lot of people who have a point of view and want to share it. And very rarely will you see that the site is actually monetized. So there's a big difference in that. So that was one of the, before launching the site, that was one of the things that I really had to think about and plan for. How am I going to sustain it financially? Right. And so I had to be very clear about who my readers were going to be. And from that, develop an advertising plan and a kit, and that I could approach the right, you know, sort of businesses that would be interested in my readership. Now, luckily for me, I think that I am in probably the most culturally rich areas of the United States right now, and most diverse. So in terms of the types of people I can reach out to for advertising, it spans the gamut, you know, from small banks to bakeries, to really, it's small businesses. Right. Being a hyper-local, you're going to be focused on the small businesses in the neighborhood. And one of the reasons why I'm no longer at Patch, they let all of the Patch editors go back in August. They've maintained a few. I'm not really sure what they're doing with the site now, but the reason that they gave us was that they were having trouble sustaining it financially, you know, with the small businesses. So that was definitely a concern of mine when I was thinking about launching The Reader. I'm like, how am I going to sustain this? If a company such as AOL Patch is having trouble doing that, what am I going to do different? And just from meeting with some small businesses, I had to do a lot of sit downs to talk to them about their needs and what they were looking for if they were a potential advertiser. I found out that a lot of those businesses didn't feel as though AOL or a corporate company coming into the neighborhood trying to benefit or profit financially off of them, that wasn't something they were interested in participating in. They were wary. You know, they did get some advertising, but they were wary. But I was at that point, after working for 3 years as the editor and covering the neighborhood, I had become a brand in many people's eyes. I had a relationship, and the way I had covered the news in the past, I was able to develop trust. So you really have to know your readers.
Right. You really know, just as you were talking and thinking about, there's a school that I remember the motto that they said. It's a school for people who are in the arts, who love the arts, who love music and theater, that we try to provide you with an education that teaches you how to make money at what you're passionate about doing. And right. It seems that that's what you've been able to do. When you take your background in journalism and in public relations and media, and you talked earlier about loving to do business plans and proposals, you've brought all of that together
right.
in order to come up with a plan. So you just gave us a little tiny mini course on how to start your business and to do what you love doing.
Well, if you let your passion lead you, and that's really, really important. It's almost taking a leap of faith. But if you let your passion lead you, your consumers, your clients, whoever it is that you're trying to reach, feel that. And then that comes back to you, usually in the form of money.
Right.
So, I think that's the key
right.
as well.
So just moving forward, you were motivated to do this. You had worked for AOL Patch. But what is the status of what's happening in terms of journalism? I mean, right now we have a program at Medgar Evers College in professional writing. I'm chair of the department, but I also recognize that we can't just offer journalism the way we used to. We have to really rev up the program because there's so much happening in the publishing world, around publishing books. There's so much happening with journalism. There's so many people who've lost jobs. I mean, as you just mentioned, what's your take on what's happening and what are some options for us? What's the future looking like? I know that's several questions.
No, what's happening in journalism right now is almost like a slow, silent death.
Mm.
But what from anything that dies, something new is born. So it's not...
Change is important.
Yes, it's
change
not...
Change is always sometimes good.
There's a tug of war going on right now. I think there's a tug of war going on because of the internet and because so much news has moved to the internet and because there's so much information, where we found that the reader is non-discriminate in terms of where they're seeking their information. They may get some news from a gossip site. They don't evaluate that necessarily any higher than information that they get from the New York Times site. They may, mm-hmm. if they're an astute reader. It depends on probably a little bit their education level and how much they read. But in general, there's no distinction being drawn anymore because of how much noise is on the internet and how much information and news is flying across the internet. There's no clear distinction between journalism and just people giving their opinion. And because how easy it is for people to access a site, put a site up and put themselves use themselves as a purveyor of information or news, people are gobbling it up. It's almost like people aren't making a distinction between a McDonald's hamburger and, a vegan meal.
So what do we do? I mean, that's a challenge we face in academy and in our public school system all the time. How do we get young people to be more critical readers and even writers? How do we get the public to be much more critical? What can we do to make people more discriminating and what is it that you're doing when you were thinking about the Brooklyn Reader? Who is that reader? What's your sense of who that reader is? I know that was, again, a number of questions. But so who's the reader? And then what can we do to make people more critical readers and writers?
The reader encompasses the community, my community. And that community encompasses so many people. Right now, Central Brooklyn is being gentrified. So we have, in the past 10 years, we have new residents. We have new residents that have a specific taste in art, culture, music, information. We also have the residents that have been here through the years who are aging. They also have a specific interest in art, culture, preservation, and history. We also have young people who are coming out of college that have a different sensibility about information and news and technology. So my reader, I have not, unlike, maybe an Essence magazine that has a very targeted audience, my reader is specific but not specific at the same time. So I'm trying to really do almost a coordinated dance of reaching everybody at the same time. What?
But they're still selected because these are the people who are online.
Yes. There are people that are going to come online who would be online anyway. And there are, then those that have come online, they're going to choose where they decide to go online. So I would say the majority of my readers are definitely usually college educated. They are usually in the age range between mid-20s to and above. It can get as high as, you know, maybe 50, 60. But after 60, you have fewer people really engaging online. And then a lot of people who are a lot of the gentrifiers. And I don't want to narrow gentrifiers down to being just, a lot of times we think of gentrification, we think in terms of race. And really, gentrification is about class.
Yes,
I'm a gentrifier. That's the bottom line. I've been here now 16 years, but I'm a gentrifier. You know, what I bring to the table is no different than a lot of the other people who have moved into the neighborhood newly, except for the fact that I have a different sensibility and a different culture and a background. So my treatment of the neighborhood is different. But back to who those readers are going to be, a lot of the gentrifiers are the ones that are coming online because they want to know what's going on in this neighborhood. This is my new domicile. This is where I'm living now. What kind of crime is happening around the corner? What type of people am I living next to? What kind of culture is available to me? What kind of restaurant is this that, you know, is around the corner? Is it reputable? Does it have a good grade? Is the food good? So it's usually the people who have some, you know, income mobility, some, you know, upper mobility and a higher income and some education. The readers, you know, and yeah.
Okay, so going back to that, you do have critical readers, so you don't have to work towards doing that. But going back to the question is, in general, and I agree with you that readers are less discriminatory and or discriminating. And so how do we get young people in our schools, how do we get people to be more critical? And in part of what we do, the mission of the Center for Black Literature, mm-hmm. for example, is to expose a wider range of readers to the literature produced by Black writers and okay. to help people to recognize that the kind of writing Black writers do is cannot just be put into one category.
Right.
There are multiple perspectives, there are multiple voices, there are multiple genres, there are people are writing from different classes. And so we have to think about literature in different ways, the literature produced by Black writers in different ways. We have to think about the different strategies for how we make people clearer, more critical, and still respect their culture and their space from which they're writing.
Absolutely. And that, when I was really in the process of developing the direction for the Brooklyn Reader, I made a decision to myself, and even it actually happened before when I was at Bed-Stuy Patch in terms of my writing and reporting. I'd seen the differences and I had become frustrated within myself because I came through the traditional journalism model. I came up reading The New Yorker and The New York Times and then Toni Morrison. I came up reading some of the best writing out there, and that's what I loved. I wanted other people to taste it and consume it as well. So I made a commitment to myself that I would try to be that person that provides information that is accurate and that inspires critical thinking. And I'm still, that's my goal now. Being that it's a hyperlocal, excuse me, there's still a sort of balance that I have to draw, to kind of bring in between making it a very friendly space too, and not too highbrow that it isolates people, and making it a space that feels community-based. So the writing is a balance between very traditional journalism and what you would, a conversation that you might be having with your neighbor, which is not easy. I think that in terms of schools, you know, developing, preparing them for a writing career that makes a distinction between what's just noise and what's real writing and journalism, to always be making those comparisons to when you're looking at information, make it, there'll be certain cues, there'll be certain things that you're looking for in that writing all the time, you know, really get their minds astute in terms of being analytical and making comparisons. Because once you get into that habit, when you're reading immediately, you know what type of information you're reading. Okay, this is this type of writing. I'm not going to take it the same face value as that. Unfortunately, a lot of people, because of all the blogs that have proliferated online, a lot of people have, oh my goodness, I can't tell you how many journalism students I've that've graduated from journalism school that their grammar is horrendous and their spelling is terrible, and it's become almost accepted. The spelling online, it's just become accepted, and it's not acceptable. So always making sure that writers who write are taking into account it's not just about the development of your voice, it's not just about being prolific, it's about being accurate and making sure that they understand that that's important. You know, you don't have to just be a journalist to be accurate. I mean, you think about Wilkerson. I don't know if you read her book,
yes,
The Warmth of Other Suns.
Yes, wonderful book.
Yes, and she was a journalist. Some of the best writers out there were journalists. And so not only is she telling this story, her accuracy, her research, all of that, there's such a huge distinction between the type of writing that you get in her book and, you know, maybe an Elin Harris, which is also enjoyable for what it is, you know. McDonald's can be good sometimes for some people every now and then, you know, but you need to make a distinction. You know, McDonald's is not like eating at Whole Foods. There's a distinction. There's a difference. So always making that distinction between the types of writing, the caliber of writing. There's some good in almost all writing if there's information in there, you know, to be gleaned.
And making that clear for students. And as we come to a close, believe it or not, what is the message that you have for aspiring writers? And also just give us a little bit more about your the Brooklyn Reader. How do people get to the Brooklyn Reader online?
Okay. I want to tell aspiring writers that to read a lot. To read, just to read till you know you've got words coming out of your ears. It's so important to hear so many voices, so many different voices, to hear so many different styles. It helps you to develop your style, and it helps you to make decisions about how you want to be as a writer. But to read a lot. A lot of times we think, you know, you often hear, if you want to write, writers write. You have to cut. That's true.
Writers on writing.
Yes. If you're calling yourself a writer, definitely write. That is absolutely true. But you definitely want to be reading. You're definitely, the best comics are those you can tell that read. The best actors and actresses are those that read a lot. Reading is the key, really, at the end of the day. And even if you don't consider yourself a writer, if you're reading a lot, I bet you can write.
Okay.
Reading is the key. Okay. You can get to the Brooklyn Reader at www.bkreader.com.
And repeat it again?
www.bkreader.com. The Brooklyn Reader. We're also online. We're also on Facebook at the Brooklyn Reader. And we're also on, we have a Twitter. It's at BK Reader, and we're also on Instagram. So you'll find us in all online social media places as well. And if you're looking for writing for the community, if you live in one of the communities we cover, we'd love to have you on board. If you're an aspiring reporter, reach out to us. You can reach me at info@bkreader.com, info@bkreader.com.
Okay, thank you so much, ZAWADI Morris.
Thank you.
And
thank you for
sharing your story and for doing the work of what it takes to make a difference and following your passion. You've been listening to Writers on Writing. I am Dr. Brenda Greene, Executive Director of the Center for Black Literature, Director of the National Black Writers Conference. And I want to thank my engineer, Fritz, for always being there and being on time. And please write us, writers@mec.cuny.edu, and come back next week.
Next song was inspired by a poem written by Langston Hughes. I'm sure most of you have heard of Langston Hughes. And he wrote a poem about rivers. And we call this song, I've Known Rivers.